Hi everyone, here's The Book Chemist once again, and today I'm reviewing two of Umberto Eco's lesser-known novels, The Island of the Day Before from 1994 and Baudolino, his 2000 novel. These are very different books in so many ways, and I had a very different reaction to the two of them, but they do share some common concerns, which are, at the end of the day, the concerns of that you find across Eco's entire poetics and oeuvre. And most notably, possibly his key concern, the thing that obsesses him in his novel and that shines through all the developments of his curious, bizarre characters and his plots, is the way stories come to shape our perception of the world and our ideas of ourselves. I'm talking about stories here in a very wide definition that stretches to include both scientific theories and worldviews and also religious beliefs. And all of these stories, their common denominator is that they can all be traced to a source, to somebody, to a person who first told this story. And the interesting thing, the thing that interests Eco's texts time and again, is how these stories, by being unleashed onto the world, by being diffused throughout culture and society, come to take on a life of their own that proves unexpected and always has unexpected consequences, most notably on the people who invented and shared these stories for the first time. The stories we tell each other are made of language, just as our very consciousness is built on language. And for this very simple reason, we can never really rescind our perception of the world around us with the stories we tell ourselves to explain how this world works. And the consequence of this, which often takes on tragic notes, is that sometimes these stories that we tell each other, maybe with good intentions, maybe to assuage our fears or to soothe our anxieties, can have unexpected consequences and influence the world in very real and perceivable ways. The other great concern of these books is the central concern of all historical fiction, that that paradoxical, ambivalent game that is played by all historical fiction, all fiction that makes a point of stretching and characterizing its place in time, which some might argue is all fiction in general. This ambivalent game, by virtue of which these books at once highlight the peculiarity of their historical period, how respectively the 17th century in Ireland and the 12th century in Baudolino are peculiar and different from other historical periods, how people thought at the time, what their ideas on the world and ourselves were, while at the same time also pointing at the contemporary element in these eras, how the people living then are so very close to us these days with their manias and their obsessions, their fears and worries, but also their dreams and ambitions. It's a sort of seesaw game that goes on all the time in Eco's novels, but it is always very pleasant to experience because he is so clearly very knowledgeable about these historical periods and can characterize them truly effortlessly. Of the two, The Island of the Day Before is definitely the one that plays with its historical setting most obsessively. This is a book set in the 17th century and that has a lot to say about the mentality and the worldview of that specific peculiar century in European history and in world history, a center that was at the heart of the whole modern period that truly changed the relationships of power between various nations around the world and the relationships of power between different classes of European society. One of the key concerns in the novel is this idea that the nobility of the past is losing its importance and its status more and more because of social advances, but even more importantly because of technological innovations, just as you find in the fiction of great historical novelists I'm thinking most notably of Thomas Pynchon. You see here how technology and human society and culture are so indelibly bound, how the advances in technology and scientific thought bring along all sorts of changes in the way we relate to one another, in the way our economies work, in the way our priorities change, that one might not instinctively connect to, say, the development of guns and gunpowder, or to developments in navigation technology, but that are in fact rooted precisely there. Eco's obsession with what we call il Seicento, the 17th century in Italian, was so strong that actually researching how the book was written is quite fun. Apparently Eco immersed himself in 17th century writings as he was researching and writing the novel, and isolated himself a little bit in this echo chamber, oh the irony, in this echo chamber of 17th century thought. Which is interesting because the character, the protagonist, Roberto, is also isolated in the novel. The peculiar, interesting premise of the island's plot is the idea that Roberto is the only person in history who ever landed not on a desert island, but on a desert ship. In the first chapter of the novel, following a shipwreck, he somehow wakes up floating on the ocean, just under a ship, apparently uninhabited, that he is able to climb on board of. He climbs on the ship, there's nobody around, he can see land on the horizon, but he has no immediate way of reaching it. He starts investigating what's going on this ship, and, well, the fabulous, mysterious events of the novel depart from there. L'isola keeps jumping between the novel's present, Roberto's experiences on the ship, and his past, the story of his life. And the first half of the novel focuses in particular on the siege of Casale, which was quite important for European history and was definitely very important. It was a foundational moment in Roberto's life and his perception of himself. Lots of things happened to his father, to other friends he made in Casale, to his ideas about the world while he was taking part in this bloody, tremendous, dragged siege. The feeling you inevitably get from both of these narratives is one of stagnation. Both as he is trapped on this ship without any apparent means of leaving it, and as he is trapped in Casale with the enemy outside the city walls and the gates, unable really to break the siege or to flee. In both of these scenarios, Roberto is, well, he's trapped and he's surrounded by fascinating mysteries, interesting characters in Casale, lots of strange things and strange rooms aboard this ship, including a mysterious stranger that might or might not be sharing the ship with him. He is trapped and he's surrounded by all these mysteries, but yet he remains trapped. And you as the reader, I most definitely perceived a certain feeling of stillness and immobility. It's very difficult to reconcile the requirements of a plot and of a novel with this feeling of immobility. And the way Eco plays it is that on the one hand, it generally gives you enough new developments in each chapter, maybe the discovery of a new wacky room aboard the ship, or maybe like a small development in the situation with the siege in Casale. He gives you a little bit of something to keep you going with every chapter, and at the same time he focuses on a new development, a new strand, a new side of thought, of scientific, humanistic, cultural thought of this in the 17th century. One chapter might focus exclusively on the way this century considered the world and the position of the world within the cosmos. One chapter might focus on theological debates that were really crucial to the thinkers of the time. By highlighting the conflict in thought and in different worldviews, this thought between the first rays of the 18th century's Enlightenment and a more conservative, backward-looking, orthodox form of religious thinking. By highlighting this conflict between these different ways of approaching the world, Eco is always and only focusing on the doubts and conflicts within the heart of its own protagonist. Considering this is, once again, a novel about a guy who's just stuck on a ship, unable to go Anywhere. This novel mirrors precisely that kind of obsessiveness with his own thoughts that he must have experienced himself as he is trapped in such a hellish scenario. Spitzfindigkeit is the Yiddish word I learned from Howard Jacobson to describe this sort of obsessive scrutinizing of one's own thoughts, and there's definitely a lot of Spitzfindigkeit that goes on in L'Isola del Giorno Prima, together with quite a lot of passages describing the variety of the fauna in the southern hemisphere of the world, the constellations that people the night sky of this place, the recent developments in siege technology, all sorts of developments that felt new and mind-blowing to the people of the 17th century. All of these chapters describe this thing through virtuosistic lists, through a bizarre form of stream of consciousness that doesn't quite mirror the thoughts of any individual character as much as the thoughts of the era itself. All of this new discovering, inflaming scientific thought, inflaming culture discussions in the salons and the universities of the time. You've probably already realized this from all the things I've been mentioning, but L'Isola del Giorno Prima is inevitably a very cerebral, very self-obsessed, and very slow novel. And I don't... All three of these things sound really bad, but I don't think they necessarily are. I think it's just important that you understand this is the kind of book you're getting yourself into. It's not like there's no action in here. There's a war and a desert island and lots of other funny and interesting things. And it's not like there's not any humor. Padre Caspar, Father Caspar in particular, is one of Eco's most successful characters. He is... completely hilarious, and the scene where Father Caspar tries to use his newfangled scuba diving device to, well, traverse a body of water is, I kid you not, one of the tensest scenes I've read all year. I read The Island of the Day Before in 2020, and I was literally on the edge of my seat, on the edge of the couch, actually, waiting to see what would happen. Father Caspar, where are you? Please, Father Caspar, talk to me. But possibly because it's such a tense scene, the novel kind of never recovers from it. And I do feel that the second half of The Island of the Day Before feels a little bit too self-involved and loses itself a little bit in all of these linguistic and scientific and intellectual games that the first half has set up. In all of these things, The Island of the Day Before reminds me a lot of The Name of the Rose, easily Umberto Eco's most famous novel, but possibly the one I enjoyed the least among his works. Not that I didn't enjoy it, it's still obviously a great novel, it's just that the great elements in Name of the Rose were kind of dragged down by Eco's reflections on the time of the novel, Eco's historical and intellectual reflections, whereas in Eco at his best, the very opposite happens, and all of the really stimulating intellectual reflection only sustains and supports the narrative and makes the characters and their story more interesting. For all that, it has one of the most fascinating premises in Eco's oeuvre. It's definitely, you know, guy lands on desert ship is definitely more enthralling than, you know, middle-aged Milanese in an office tell each other stories to pass the time. At the same time, I would say that this is a book for the fans, a book for the Eco fans. Please contradict me if you think I'm wrong. We can then move to Baudolino, which is a completely different novel and a very different experience. For all that, as I said, humor finds its way in L'Isola del Giorno Prima, and there are quite a lot of funny characters and quite a lot of witty reflections on its time, humor is all over Baudolino. Baudolino is such a hilarious experience, which only makes the great poignancy and the great tragedy of its plot all the more relevant. This book is set in the late 12th, early 13th century, a brutal time in European history, a time of early death, great suffering, continuous constant war across the continent, and great strife throughout throughout the Mediterranean, Europe, the Middle East, etc. And yet, all of these characters, all the characters peopling it, are described and are portrayed as, well, people just trying to do their best with what they're given. Peasants just trying to make a living and trying not to be swindled by those tricky people from the next town over. Emperors convinced that they're acting for the good of all their people and that they need to crush rebellions just because that's in the best interest of their citizens. It's a book that confronts face on one of the great paradoxes of history, which is that people at the end of the day, homo homini lupus, and people tend to be bastards to each other, but at the end of the day they are kind of relatable, or at least they are, well, humane, for how silly that sounds, at the same time as the history that all together they build can very often be monstrous and atrocious and hellish. I'm getting ahead of myself. What Baudolino is first and foremost is the wondrous, the amazing adventures of this peculiar protagonist, easily Eco's best protagonist, this boy from the plains / swamps of Lombardy Piedmont, who, because of some strange gift, because of a trick of nature, can speak any language he hears. He can, so long as he hears a few lines of a language, he can then he learns it instantly and can then talk to the people speaking it. I wish I had that gift. I guess Eco sort of had the gift himself. He was famously well-versed in all languages ever. Baudolino is the son of poor farmers, but because of a twist of fate, because of one of the many twists of fate in his life, he will come to play a central role in many developments of European history of the time. He will come to be very close to Frederick Barbarossa in particular, the emperor of the sacred, the Holy Roman Empire. He'll study in Paris at the university, he'll become an ambassador to foreign lands, he'll become a mediator in the many conflicts between the emperor and the people of Lombardy, the people of northern Italy, constantly rebelling against the emperor while at the same time also wishing to exploit his influence and to keep on his good side. He'll be surrounded by a plethora of unforgettable characters, poets and musicians and debauched monks and so on and so forth, all, as in Umberto Eco's best tradition, fictionalized versions of real-life historical figures. And he'll do his best to cope with the requirements of a brutal time. And one of the central concerns of Baudolino, one of the things that make his character so interesting, is that he is, in so many ways, a very good person. He abhors violence, he tries to find the best solution to all problems that arise between, say, the emperor and his native lands. He wants to avoid bloodshed, he wants to be of help to anybody. And yet, maybe because of this, potentially because of this, he is constantly surrounded by tragedy and destruction. There's a joke going on in the novel that Baudolino cannot visit a city without the city being razed to the ground. Part of this might simply be the injustice of the world and the horror of it. In the words of rapper LP, life's a tragedy generator operating at mass capacity. But the suspicion is always there that Baudolino's own actions and decisions might cause these accidents and might bring forth these tragedies because of his incapacity to, say, commit or make difficult decisions. It's another of those central concerns in Eco that I was talking about at the beginning of the video. It's this idea of cowardice, this idea of having these characters who are unable to act on their impulses and are always worried about their shame, about not being men of action. Foucault's Pendulum is concerned with this very much. All of Eco's novels are concerned with them. The Prague Cemetery is too. And even Roberto in The Island of the Day Before is definitely somebody who struggles with acting on his impulses and on his wishes. And this expresses itself in Baudolino, in The Island, everywhere in Umberto Eco, most notably with having these protagonists who are always in love with a woman, but and they are madly and passionately in love with her, but can never really act on this, they can never really express their feelings, they can never really persuade these women of their good intentions or try to establish any sort of relationship with them. And these obsessions, by the way, always tell you much more about the character, about these male protagonists themselves, than they tell you about, say, the nature of love, except that in that these characters then become archetypes for other types of obsessive, dysfunctional lovers. My discussion of Baudolino has gone a little bit all over the place. One thing I should mention is that Baudolino is the anti-Ireland when it comes to its plot. Ireland, as I said, is a rather stagnating book. These constantly moves forward with its plot, with new developments at every turn, new characters cropping up in every chapter. There's a frame narrative here. Baudolino is telling the story of his life as he and a nobleman from Constantinople called Niceta have just survived the siege of Constantinople in the Fourth Crusade, when the Christian crusaders headed toward Jerusalem just stopped in Constantinople and sacked it. Instead, they just survived this terrible destruction and mayhem. And the novel keeps going back to this frame narrative and to the events of Baudolino and Niceta trying to flee Constantinople. But that's never annoying. This interruption of the novel's present on the flow of the events is never annoying. Instead, it allows the text to reflect on these events in the past, to put them into different perspective, and just to take a break from the breakneck speed of the novel's plot. For all that, Umberto Eco is one of my very, very favorite writers. I'll be the first to admit that in all of his novels, there's always that suspicion that they end two or three chapters after they've outstayed their welcome, or at least after they should have ended. Whereas in Baudolino, at least, the frame narrative toward the novel's conclusion provides a very poignant, very fascinating and fabulous ending that makes this a wonderful piece of fantasy. Because it's what it is, because for all of its historical accuracy and for all of how it plays with historical figures, in its second half, Baudolino takes a huge leap and becomes a wonderful work of imaginative fantasy fiction. Baudolino is what H.P. Lovecraft's The Dream Quest of Unknown Kedath, with its wonderful vistas and its bizarre peoples and monsters, could have been and quite isn't. It's a wonderful piece of fantasy, but I also realize that because this shift in the second half of the novel comes along so suddenly, lots of people will struggle with it, and lots of people will hate the turn of events late into Baudolino. I adored it because I don't have a problem with fantasy, and because the whimsical tone of the novel always made it feel like a little bit of a fantasy anyway. But I'm curious to hear from others, and I'm curious to hear from people, if they exist, who were quite fed up with all of the bizarre people who live in the kingdom of Prince of King John, the priestly king. I struggle to translate this stuff, I read it in Italian. Another thing I should mention, which is very relevant for Baudolino, but possibly a bit for The Island too, is that a lot of the humor in the book, and even more, a lot of the dialogue, a lot of the pace of the novel, is based on the language and the humor of Northern Italy, of Lombardy in particular, and Piedmont and Alessandria, and these border regions between Lombardy and the Northwest. It's based on the idea of these people who are quite full of themselves, quite arrogant, always crafty, quick to anger but also quick to remorse, and most notably never afraid of pulling down to their level people who think they are better than them. When Baudolino comes back to his parents after he's become such an important figure in the empire, obviously the first thing they tell him is, oh, well, why didn't you come visit us sooner? Don't think you're anything important just because you hang with the nobility these days. I wonder how well these forms of humor and the rhythm of this language translates into English, and I'm very curious to hear from people who read the novel in English. I want to hear whether you appreciated it, whether you could perceive the difference at the different attitudes of the Northern Italian, the Alessandria characters, compared to the other people, the other people in this immense cast of characters. More broadly speaking, I'm really curious to hear what you thought about these two novels. If it wasn't clear from the way I was talking about them, I really loved Baudolino. it's up there with Foucault's Pendulum, probably, in terms of my favorite Eco novel, and it was quite possibly the most enjoyable of his books I've read so far. I do wonder, of course, because Lombardy is my neck of the woods, I do wonder how much of that personal connection influenced my appreciation of the novel. That's another thing I'm interested in discussing. I wasn't a huge fan of The Island of the Day Before. I enjoyed it as an Eco fan, but my patience was running out, especially in the second half of the novel. What did you think? What did you think of these books? Did you enjoy them? Do you rank them among Eco's best novels? Do you think they deserve this reputation as minor works? I really look forward to discussing it with you in the comment section. As always, thank you so much for watching an especially rambling review today, and bye everyone.